All right. Thanks, everyone, for having me. It's my first time in Europe and in Berlin. It's been pretty awesome. So this talk, I'm going to be talking about my experiences with maintaining Babel. And just a little intro for me. My Twitter handle is left_pad. And I maintain Babel, Lerna, and a bunch of other open source projects. I really like board games. One of my favorites is Seven Wonders. And I haven't played the Babel expansion yet, but I'm looking forward to it. I also like Korean barbecue. I took Sean Larkin of Webpack to his first time in California. And I'm addicted to open source. This is just, I went to a restaurant in New York City, and that reminded me of the GitHub contribution graph. So this talk isn't going to be about wanting to get people to contribute to open source or becoming a maintainer, just to give you a picture of what it's like to be a maintainer, maybe give some more awareness of what that's like. So how did I get started in open source? I'm from Atlanta, Georgia, and my first introduction to open source was through hackathons. You know, the first project I made with JavaScript was just vanilla.js. I didn't know about any libraries or things like Bootstrap or Angular. Eventually, I learned how to use npm and download libraries like D3. My first pull request to GitHub was to Khan Academy, and I used this website called First PR to figure out what it was, and I actually realized that it wasn't merged because I didn't know how to use Rebase. So you can see that I just have all these commits there. When I first started working, I met this guy called Jonathan Neal, and he encouraged me to get started in open source because I was using Angular at the time. I tried to figure out how to get started. I read all the contributing docs. I read through all the documentation again. I went through all the issues, but it was really hard for me to find a place to get started. But I found that there was an issue about updating the linting config, and I was like, oh, it's just updating some JSON. So I went in and made a PR for that, except I found out I had to learn how to use npm shrink wrap and all this crazy stuff. Eventually, I ended up being the number 22 committer on Angular, and that was only because I updated the styling. I didn't do any core changes. So all these changes were manually fixed by me, because we didn't have auto-fixing or prettier or anything like that. And it was really cool because Igor, which is one of the maintainers, he even reached out, emailed me, and asked if I wanted to get a t-shirt. And then I wanted to contribute more to Angular, but then I realized I had no idea what was going on in the code base. So I figured because I was working out this styling, I should check out the project that I was contributing to. And so I found JSCS, which is a linter. And that repo was really cool because they had a help wanted label. And that was, it made it easy for me to contribute. So my first PR to this project was just adding this table of contents. Over time, I ended up doing more fixes, like bug fixes and new rules. And eventually, I got an email that said, oh, you can be on the core team, which is really awesome. And even better than that was a few months before that, I actually got an email to work at Behance, which is where two of the maintainers worked at. So I moved to New York, and right now I work at Behance, where I do JavaScript and work on Babel. So, how did I become a maintainer? Sebastian was saying that he was getting burnt out and he wanted to maintain Babel Core, and I found a different project called Babel ESLint, and I was working on a linter, so it made sense, oh, I could figure out how to contribute through that. And he wrote a blog post a while back talking about his problems with open source in the community and getting burnt out. And so, he started not working on it, and all these contributors came in. I just happened to be one of those people. And then I feel like I didn't even realize I was a maintainer until he basically told me, you know, you slowly did more and more stuff. So it just kind of creeps up on you, and then realize you're like, oh, why? I'm a maintainer now. But the problem was that I felt like I was a contributor the whole time I was being a maintainer, and that led me to only doing the things that I thought were easy. So like I would fix docs or fix bugs. I would never like look into the code and like figure out how to make core changes. And it's funny because people were asking me all these questions. I didn't know the answer either, so I just have to like look it up and then like send them a message, be like, okay, this is what it is. But then I guess nobody knew that I didn't really know what it was either. Yeah, so then that led me to think that the project wasn't moving forward. All we're doing is maintaining what someone else already created. And I felt like at any point that Sebastian would come back and tell me like what to do or like what the vision of the project was. And only recently where it's like, oh, okay, we are the maintainers. We should figure out what the priorities are, what the roadmap is, how to move forward. And a lot of that led to just thinking about like, why do we do open source in the first place? When you get really involved in something, whether it's work or open source or anything else, you know, we start thinking that that's where we get our worth from. And when it doesn't go well, then we start suffering. We start thinking like, what are we working towards? Yeah, so this makes you think that everyone thinks that maintainers know everything, and they have the answers to everything, but we're just other developers that you know, figured out how to look it up. So yeah, how do we actually measure success in open source? I think we glamorize like all the downloads. We have like 8 million downloads a month and like all these stars, and but then at the same time, like, you know, OSS 1, like everyone's using open source now, but what was the cost of that, right? We have all these people that are volunteering to, you know, spend their time working on this thing for all these companies and people, but like, what are we actually getting out of this? So it's like where I think that it's not just like work that we put in, but like how we do it, right? That I want to make sure that when we do ask people to join open source or become maintainers, that we figure out how to do it sustainably. So I'm just going to talk about a few stories. So GitHub Issues. A lot of people use GitHub Issues. A lot of people switch off of GitHub Issues. We're probably the only project that switched and then went back to GitHub Issues. A while back, Sebastian posted about how GitHub was not a good, you know, use for managing issues. And so we moved to this thing called Fabricator. And a lot of people complained about it. So some of the positives. There was a lot less back and forth because you people had to like say what Babel version they're using, the input and the output. And so it was a lot easier to actually reproduce issues. It also led to more people talking in PRs because we had to disable the issues. And they had a lot more features like merging duplicates and like reactions and all that stuff. But it ended up being that there was a lot more negatives. All the previous GitHub links weren't available anymore. So if you had a blog post or any link to a GitHub issue, it would just fail. The issue tab is gone. So if you're like just coming to this project for the first time, you're like, where's the issues? And that led to people doing a lot of weird things like emailing me directly or making a comment in the commit of the repo or making issues on the website repo rather than the actual repo. It also led to less issues, which I think is like, it feels like it's good, but I heard from a lot of people that they didn't even want to do it because they had no idea how to use the interface. And also over time, GitHub made a lot of improvements so that it felt reasonable to move back. So we had to make more code to convert all the issues to GitHub. It was insane. I didn't even do any of the work. Daniel, which is one of the team members, he had to write all this code to turn SQL queries into GitHub API calls and make sure that it doesn't ping anybody and that all the URLs redirect to the new GitHub URLs. And so we made a Babel bot, and you can see that it imported 772 repos, and it basically copy-pasted the issue contents. And when we finally did this, everybody was excited, me too, because I felt like in the other interface, I started not looking at the issues either and stopped caring. All right, more frustration. So NPM packages. So we have Babel preset 2015, and I was like, well, it's 2016 now, so I guess I should make a Babel 2016. And then I find out that someone already made that. But this person was really nice, and they said it was their pleasure to let you know give the package up to Babel. And then now I just thought, well, what about the next year, right? And then I go to, and I find out someone already made that too. But then this person didn't really want to give up the name, which actually kind of hurts our project because it makes it sound like the package they made was official. And so that was like a long back and forth, and like a month later, we were able to get the project. But the real solution is to use what NPM has now with scopes so that everything under the at Babel name would be official. And we haven't done that yet, but we're looking into it. And then the next thing would be that we should just stop making preset ES2020XX because then we'll have 100 config values. And it looks like people that actually know what scope packages are willing to try it out. okay. So I think some of you might have seen this blog post. And in it, Jordan talks about how Babel has this picture of Guy Fieri in it. And there's nothing you can do about it, right? And it was fun. And then James made this PR that added this. I was kind of surprised at first, but you know, went with it. It was cool. And then you get cool comments like this, which is really awesome to read. And then we see this. Mariko made this, and then I was like, okay, let's change the color scheme. And then I met Jordan for the first time. and then, yeah, so, and then I was like, Jordan, you should write an April Fool's blog post for us too. You can be like our like chief marketing officer. And he was busy, so I just made up this other thing based on Wikipedia. Okay, so I've been talking a lot about open source and where it's heading and that, you know, we should make it sustainable. So how do we actually do that? One way is by getting more contributors. So what we're doing on that front is trying to focus more on like beginner-friendly issues, making like actually explaining what you need to do, not just being like, hey, if you know all these terminologies and these words, that you'll figure it out. We're also participating in Google Summer of Code. So we're going to have two students that will be working with us, and also Rails Girls Summer of Code. And we can also partner with a lot of other organizations like schools or boot camps or companies. If you are a company that's using Babel, then if you want to sponsor us, let me know. And yeah, even so my company is really awesome. They're letting me work 50% of the time on Babel. And the only reason why we have preset NV is because I was able to work on it at work for 2 weeks. And we're also partnering with TC39. TC39 is the committee that works on JavaScript. And Babel is a good, big part of that, right? Because we write all these like stage zero plugins before it's actually in the spec. And the reason why it's a good idea is because then people can actually use the syntax before we decide it's a good idea. And Logan was able to go to the last TC39 meeting in March, and I'm planning on going in May. We set up an open collective. And so what is the future of Babel? now that I feel like I am a maintainer, then we were working on an actual roadmap. We're trying to split up into teams, delegate, and we're trying to partner with a lot of different people. So I think once we figure it out, like, we have a level of control, we can do a lot of awesome stuff. So yeah, look out for Babel 7. Thanks.